And the reason why I'm here talking is because I've worked with lots of English Cocker Spaniels, and you guys have helped support my research to study the two diseases we're going to talk about today, which is Addison's disease and immune-mediated hemolytic anemia. My goal for this talk is to just tell you guys a little bit about the diseases, how they start, things to look for if you see these problems in your own dogs or in dogs that are owned by some of your clients. And then I'm going to talk a little bit about the genetics and immune-mediated research that I have going on, and give you guys an opportunity to ask questions at the end. I'll say that, like, as I'm going through this, if you guys have any questions about things that I'm saying, if there's anything that's like seems technically complicated, just raise your hand. Like, I mean for this to be pretty informal, and I want you guys to get as much out of this as you can, and make sure it's all understandable. Does that sound good? Great. So let's go ahead and get started. So we're going to, just a quick overview of what I'm going to talk about in this talk here. So first we're going to talk about Addison's disease and what is Addison's disease. Then we'll talk about IMHA, and then we'll talk about the research studies that I have going on. And we'll start with Addison's disease. So I'll start off by saying, like, well, what is Addison's? So Addison's disease is this disorder of a part of the body that we call the adrenal glands. And to give you guys a little bit of a context for what the adrenal glands are, so this is a human kidney, or human kidneys, it's just easier to get a picture of it, but they look kind of a lot like dog kidneys. And we have a kidney on the left and a kidney on the right, and the kidneys here are kind of wearing this hat. And that's what we call the adrenal gland. So in me and you, the adrenal glands live about here. If you take a dog, you just kind of rotate everything 90 degrees, and the adrenal glands are these glands that live just in front of the kidneys in a dog. And when we look at the adrenal gland, kind of clinically, most of the time, we look at it by an ultrasound image. And we typically think of the adrenal gland as looking like a peanut. So can you see this sort of organ here that's in an ultrasound image? This is a dog's left adrenal gland, which typically is a little bit bigger than the right adrenal gland. But importantly, to think about Addison's disease and how Addison's disease comes about, you have to actually look a little bit more at what the adrenal gland looks like on the inside. And we call that looking at the histology, or what an adrenal gland looks like under a microscope. So if you were to break up an adrenal gland a little bit more, it starts out by having this capsule, which is this outer pink layer right here. And then it has this middle layer here called the adrenal cortex. And that's the part of the adrenal gland where Addison's disease actually takes place. In the inside of the adrenal gland is this part called the adrenal medulla, sort of the core of the adrenal gland. When we think about the fight or flight response that's mediated by a hormone called epinephrine, that's secreted by the inside of the adrenal gland, and that's totally unaffected in dogs that have Addison's disease. So Addison's disease just affects the outer layer of the adrenal gland called the adrenal cortex. That makes sense? So if you were to look at this even further, you see there are these kind of three boxes here, and that's because when you look at it more closely under a microscope, there are three different layers of the adrenal cortex, and this is kind of breaking those layers out, and I'm sorry these pictures don't project that well, but here again is the adrenal gland on the left. You have the inside here being the medulla, this yellow stuff, which is the capsule, and then this light pink stuff here, which is the cortex. If you were to break it up and look at it even closer, there's actually these three layers of the adrenal gland. So the first outer layer, we call it the zona glomerulosa. We typically just abbreviate it with a G. There's the zona fasciculata, which is the middle layer. And then there's the inner layer of the cortex called the reticularis. So these three layers, G, F, and R, make up the adrenal cortex. And why it's important to know a little bit about these different layers of the adrenal gland is that the cells in each of these layers are actually responsible for making some really important hormones in the body. And the outermost layer, called, again, the glomerulosa, produces this really important hormone called aldosterone. And the middle layer produces a hormone called cortisol. And these are the hormones that basically animals with Addison's disease lose because they can no longer make them. So Addison's disease is essentially when the body attacks these specific layers of the adrenal cortex and leads to the inability to produce these hormones, which are really, really important for the body to function normally. Does that kind of make sense? So this is actually what it looks like. So if you have a dog that's actually affected by Addison's disease, and we don't normally sample adrenal gland tissue because it's really hard to hit the adrenal gland with a needle, but sometimes when you're doing an autopsy on an animal that happened to die of either Addison's disease or unrelated things to Addison's disease, but it had Addison's disease, and you look at the adrenal gland, can you guys see all these like blue dots here that are in the middle of the adrenal tissue? So these are cells of the immune system that are actually destroying this dog's adrenal gland. So all of this pink stuff around it, this is the adrenal cortex, and these blue dots in here are actually busy destroying that adrenal cortex, and that's essentially what Addison's disease is, when you have infiltrates of these cells that destroy the cortex and lead you to not being able to produce the hormones that are necessary for kind of normal life functions. Okay? So in order to kind of think a little bit more about what are these normal life functions that are lost in patients with Addison's disease, we need to think a little bit about what these hormones, cortisol and aldosterone, do. So what does cortisol do? So here's just a picture of what cortisol is, kind of not really important here, but just to throw something on the slide. So one of the things that cortisol does is it's really important for production of glucose and sugar from proteins and fats. So cortisol is really important for that. Insulin is a really important hormone in the body that helps lower our blood sugar, like after a meal, it helps glucose get absorbed by cells. It actually has a balance to it to offset the effect of insulin, and cortisol typically does that. It also has certain anti-inflammatory effects. It helps control the smooth muscle that lives in all of the blood vessels in our body, so it helps the blood vessels constrict normally. And it's really important for the health and the maintenance of the gastrointestinal tract, particularly the stomach and the intestines. So you can imagine if you have a dog or a person, right, because people can get Addison's disease too, without cortisol, and a lot of these things aren't happening, you could have like a lot of problems, right? And we'll talk about what some of those problems might be in just a second. So the other hormone that I mentioned that's really important is this hormone called aldosterone. And there's kind of a lot of scientific stuff on the slide that I don't want to go through here, but what aldosterone does is it works pretty much exclusively in the kidneys, or that's where its most important function is. So here you have some aldosterone that's floating around in the bloodstream, and importantly, aldosterone works on certain cells. This blue thing here is a cell in the kidney, and it tells the kidney to excrete potassium and absorb sodium. So it's really responsible for controlling these electrolytes, sodium and potassium, in the level of the kidney. And when you have inability to kind of reabsorb sodium or inability to get rid of potassium in the body because you don't have aldosterone, it can have some really, really significant consequences for animals, particularly, and people, particularly because potassium levels are really, really highly regulated, and if you have too much potassium in your body, your heart can basically stop pumping. So it's really important to regulate that hormone appropriately. Does this make sense so far? Any questions?
Okay.
So what do we see without these hormones? So we see in our patients with Addison's disease that they'll have chronically low sodium, high potassium, they tend to have pretty low blood sugar, they have low blood water volume because they can't control the amount of plasma in their bloodstream, they have difficulty in keeping the blood vessels constricted, and they have significant gastrointestinal upset, right? And these are mediated by the two hormones, aldosterone and cortisol. If you don't have aldosterone, you wind up with low sodium, high potassium, and sort of a shocky kind of presentation. and the cortisol leads to low blood sugar, difficulty in keeping your blood vessels constricted, and then significant gastrointestinal upset. So not having these hormones, these are the kind of things that we typically see in our patients with Addison's disease. So there's two types of Addison's disease fundamentally that I think you guys should know a little bit about. And we call them both typical Addison's disease and atypical Addison's disease. And the reason why we call typical Addison's disease typical is it's the most common form of Addison's disease that we see in our patients. But I think it's really important for you guys as readers to know a little bit about atypical Addison's disease, because that's actually one of the hard diseases to diagnose. And I think sometimes even veterinarians can have trouble picking up on what atypical Addison's disease is. So it's one of those things that if you're aware of it, you can sometimes help educate other people, hey, maybe it's something we should consider testing for. And so we'll talk about these two forms of what they are. So typical Addison's disease is, we've been talking about these hormones, cortisol and aldosterone. And in typical Addison's disease, you lose both of them. So you lose both the cortisol and aldosterone. And it's really pretty much a slam dunk diagnosis that most veterinarians would be able to make just based upon the normal blood work that we run on patients that are coming into the hospital, either because they're sick or we just want to do routine wellness checks. Because I mentioned that aldosterone causes changes in both sodium and potassium, and we measure sodium and potassium on routine blood work. Patients with typical Addison's disease oftentimes have a more severe clinical presentation, so they're oftentimes really, really sick. They can be lethargic, have really bad vomiting and diarrhea. These are the dogs that tend to get really high potassium levels, that can present with very slow heart rates. And typical Addison's disease, when you have a patient with it, they require treatment with multiple hormones to replace both the cortisol and aldosterone, and we'll talk about what those are in just a few minutes here. As far as atypical Addison's disease, so what's atypical about it is it's what? The absence of cortisol only. Still going. So okay. you basically have enough aldosterone to get by, but really clinically significant in your dog. It's much harder to diagnose on routine blood work because we don't normally measure cortisol in most patients that just come in through the hospital on routine wellness checks. It has a much, much more vague clinical presentation. So dogs with atypical Addison's disease might just be like, you know, I think she's a little bit off, or she just seems to be really picky about eating, or God, she like didn't do well when she went to the groomers and was just like a little bit off for the neck for a couple of days. But there's no major clinical abnormalities that would lead you to like bring your dog to the emergency vet or anything like that. So it can be really a vague clinical presentation. One of the nicknames for Addison's disease in humans medicine is called the Great Pretender, because it can in fact mimic so many other diseases. If you do get it though, you only have to replace one hormone, so only the cortisol. And the other thing to know is that sometimes if you do have a patient with atypical, they can actually become typical over time. So a lot of veterinarians will monitor the electrolytes in patients with atypical Addison's disease in case they become typical. So, yeah?
How fast do they usually come on the severe ones?
So the severe ones, like probably there's something brewing like for some period of time, but the dog may not present being really, really sick. But I think most of the time when you see the severe ones present, like you're gonna be like, God, they just not stopping vomiting or diarrhea in the 24 to 48 hours and they're like really sick and you're gonna be taking them to the emergency vet.
And then on the atypical, so what do they test?
So
I think
normally, unless your dog has some inkling of clinical signs, we don't just randomly test it, but I'll talk about it here in a second, but you would start off by measuring a baseline cortisol to see where the cortisol levels are, and then depending upon how that comes back, you might follow it up with an ACTH stim test, and I'll talk about those. But there are tests for it, it's just we don't typically run them. But I think if you're like, hey, you know, he's a really picky eater, or, you know, just like there can be just some, or like every once in a while they'll vomit, you know, but dogs can randomly vomit every once in a while and not have Addison's disease, you know what I mean? So there's there's so many things that can kind of mimic the clinical signs here, and that's why it's harder to diagnose. But I think particularly, and we'll talk about breed predisposition to Addison's disease, I think particularly for English Cockers, other breeds, standard poodles, Portuguese water dogs, you have to have a higher index of concern for Addison's disease because it's so common within the breed. Great question. That's also a great question. Yeah, and so typically we see the onset of Addison's disease between 1 and 3, 2 and 4 is a typical age for when dogs get it. That said, many of these atypical dogs get diagnosed later on in life because it's just missed. Do you know, like, oh, they sort of just had stomach upset and we treated it with some fluids and anti-nausea medication and they got better. So a lot of these atypical dogs, we sometimes don't see them diagnosed till 6, 7, 8 kind of thing. And sometimes it takes a stressful event to precipitate more severe clinical presentation, particularly for the atypical dogs. But great question. So what do we kind of look for in these dogs? So I think the early stages of Addison's disease are pretty vague, and this is something I would say in about 70% of the cases, this is how the diagnosis is made kind of clinically. So things like waxing and waning appetite, intermittent vomiting and diarrhea, weight loss, just kind of weakness and general tiredness, right? So these are really vague. Like, so most of the time you can have a dog with these signs and it's not gonna be Addison's disease, right? It's gonna be something else. They got into the garbage, they ate some grass, right? They played too hard, went on too long of a hike, just don't like the food that you have. You know, like there could be a zillion things that can cause these particular signs, but sometimes they are in fact signs of Addison's disease. So if you see problems like this in your own dogs, in a dog that some of your clients have, you know, it's really not super expensive to just do a baseline cortisol. We'll talk about testing in just a second, and potentially just rule out Addison's disease, especially in these predisposed breeds. I think in about 30% of the cases, so these are some of the more later and life-threatening symptoms of Addison's disease, you'll see them present with severe vomiting and diarrhea, collapse, low heart rate, low temperature, elevated kidney values, right? So these are the things you're not gonna miss. And when you think about the two types of Addison's disease, these signs are really mediated by cortisol, the lack of cortisol. These signs are mediated by the lack of aldosterone. So if you have patients that are really presenting with, or your own pets that look kind of like this, it's gonna be a relatively easy diagnosis to make by most trained emergency vets or regular vets. And this is again, the atypical dog, typically they don't progress to this kind of stage, which is why it's really not so life-threatening. So what about breeds here, right? So we're here obviously, you know, talking about English Cocker Spaniels today, and there was actually a really nice study that came out of Sweden. So one interesting thing about the Scandinavian countries is that most of their dogs have pet insurance. So it's easier to do epidemiologic studies in the Scandinavian countries because the researchers there can work with the insurance companies to look at breeds and diseases that they submit claims for, right? So this is a study that came out, I think, in 2015, 2016, but there's 525,000 dogs from all across Sweden and some other Scandinavian countries. So this is huge as far as a veterinary study is concerned. And the top five breeds that were diagnosed with Addison's is in their study. So number one was Portuguese water dogs, number two, standard poodles, the three was bearded collies, fourth were Karen Terriers, and five were English Cocker Spaniels. And so these breeds have significantly higher incidence than these breeds, but these are basically the top five breeds for Addison's disease. And it's certainly a study that you can believe.